place where real dialogue matters.
Make some noise for that sound, man.
It is time to take flight with Audio Airstrike.
This is Audio Airstrike. I'm Everett Hall McNeil. Thank you for joining us. This is episode 127. Now, I have a guest with me at this time. This is our first time meeting, and she is a podcaster for Millennials Anonymous and also a podcaster on brunching. Ladies and gentlemen, the talented Lise Winnie is with us. Thank you for joining Audio Airstrike. We definitely appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's good to talk with you on this very nice day. And we're going to get into some stuff that happened over the weekend in hip hop, particularly. One of those being Dame Dash going after who doesn't? Good grief. What has Dame Dash not gone after? Dame Dash accuses WeTV for racism around the reality show Growing Up Hip Hop. These are my thoughts about it. The issue is that when it comes to hip hop, it is a rich culture. It is a culture from the outside looking in that looks sexy to a lot of people, and a lot of people want to profit off of that. So when you have that going around and when you have those issues, it's one of those situations where sadly those who are afforded the rewards of being well off and owning these multi-million-dollar, billion-dollar industry platforms, they have built up some kind of leverage or a scheme to own a piece of hip-hop, to own a piece of the culture through different documents and stuff of that nature, through different tricks and stuff like that. What the battle that Dame is fighting is kind of like a crumb on a bigger piece of the food, if you get what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. It's one of those situations where, you know, when Dame is pointing out this stuff, and I watched a video that he posted on his IG, and he was basically saying how a lot of the executives that he saw and that he when he was at WeTV and stuff like that, and when he had to talk to E1 about certain things, he had to get clearance for certain things, that he saw a lot of the people that were getting hired did not look like him, did not look like they were of the culture. Mm-hmm. And the issue with that is, if you don't have somebody in the room that is immersed in the culture, that can speak up for the culture, that can talk at the culture, that can talk with the culture rather, instead of at the culture, you're going to have bad representation. And it's not going to set well from a cultural standpoint if, okay, we got all these office spaces and not one person for the culture is in them.
Right. I mean, I agree. I agree with you. I think that Dame Dash, though, it's Dame Dash. Like, he's been beefing with everybody from Jay-Z to, what's the guy's name with the show? I can't even think of his name right now.
Lee Daniels.
From everything from money to just saying disrespect. But my thing is that when he was with Def Jam, he didn't have all of those same complaints. Yeah, they had more black people there, but it was still a lot of white people who worked there. And even with the companies that he has probably with his wife, same deal. Or his ex-wife, rather, Rachel Roy. So I don't know if he's 100% legitimate with that. I don't know.
Yeah, it's one of those things where I think when the initial split of Rockefeller Records and people were going their separate ways, I think in certain times in life, I think when you have high success like that and it goes awry and you come back, I don't know your story too well, but it's one of those situations when you have fallouts creatively. Mm-hmm. And you have to be on the rebuilding phase. There's a certain angst that you deal with when you're trying to rebuild, because right. You ain't trying to put up with the same BS that you did with the last time.
True.
So from that perspective, I can see it. But also, Dame is, when it comes to business, when it comes to going back and forth with people, Dame is a pit bull. Jay-Z is more of a German Shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So Dame is the type of person that will bite your freaking head off if he doesn't like something. A German Shepherd is more finesse about their attacks.
Agreed. And I think Jay-Z, to me, in that situation, of course, Jay-Z won. I don't know if anybody would say Jay-Z did not win out right. of that circumstance or scenario. But I will also say with the Weed TV thing, because he was talking a lot about in the video that I saw, he was talking a lot about his kids, because his kids are on Growing Up Hip Hop. Nobody made them, you know, signed to Growing Up Hip Hop. That was a choice that they made and they continue to make. I think his biggest issue to me, Dame Dash seems like, I've never met him, so I can't say for a fact. So allegedly, he seems like the type of guy that comes in and kind of wants to do things his way. And if he can't have it his way, it's like, oh no, I can't deal with this. I think a lot of that happened with him in Jay-Z, because it was, if you're not going to do it my way, we're not going to do it at all. And I think that's kind of what happened with Weed TV, because he was okay with them exploiting the Braxtons and he was okay with them exploiting all those other shows until now. Because I was like, it's not that you didn't see it. He was like, well, I didn't know they treated people like that. But you saw those shows where they exploited Black people for years.
Mm.
So his biggest issue is that he came in and wanted to do something and they didn't want to do it his way, to me.
Yeah, I could see the point of to that. This is a lot to unpack, because we have Dame Dash, that's a very independent person, and then we have the network that, you know, if you sit over there and look at them from a certain lens as a minority, it's easy to be like, you know, naturally when you go into those circumstances and you're the only person of the culture that's there, a lot goes through your mind, like, okay, am I going to be accepted? Is my personality going to be going well with these executives? Is there any, you know, and because you're African American, is there any racism that I'm going to have to deal with that nobody else is going to have to deal with just because of how I look? Are there, is the position that opened up for me to go after, you know, this job, this potential position, like what was happening before to make this position available? Did somebody get underhandedly cut? What underhanded things were going on? What research do I need to do to make sure that the moral ethics of this company is in play? Now, all these questions come about when you are doing business.
Mm-hmm.
It's just concrete. You just have to, you know, cross your T, dot every I, do what you got to do. And I feel like you brought up a good point, because I didn't see any of the Braxtons complaining heavily about the show. If anything, if they complained about anything, it was just having beef with the other co-star and the actual situation that happened. It was never about WeTV and they tried to, you know, put an angle in for us to actually beef with each other. Now, does that happen in reality television? You doggone right it does.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things that, you know, I think we need to take into account is any time that you are doing something in entertainment, it is very crucial to make sure that, you know, you have proper communication, and also right. do your homework on every network that you work with. Potentially, if you have a partnership with somebody, if you have a distribution deal with somebody, you need to study how they do things. You need to look at their terms of service. You need to look at the privacy policy on all these companies when it comes to these deals or whatever is going on, especially if your kids are involved. Especially if it's somebody's idea and now they're not even a part of that idea. Now they moved away, which Dame referred to as well. Mm-hmm. That Growing Up Hip Hop originally wasn't their idea. It was the idea of a mutual friend. And next thing you know, he wasn't a part of it and the network took it and ran with it. So when you see stuff like that, it's very important that, you know, you have to really assess. You have to really, you know, see the silver lining, but also, you know, don't just pay attention to the rose, look at the thorns too, and then make your decision about if you want to be with this company or not.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with that. I mean, you make a good point as far as just being African American and living in this society that we live in, a society that was built by us but not built for us. So you do, there is a lot of things that you have to look at. Do I think that he has a valid point about a lot of the times outside people coming into the hip hop culture and trying to take it and own it? Yes. Do I think that the messenger is not the best messenger? Yeah. So maybe I don't look at the situation in the same regard. Like, if maybe somebody like Jay-Z would have came out and said this, I probably would have looked at it a different way. But because right. it is Dame Dash who's saying it, and you kind of know his history, and it kind of changes the perspective of it for me.
Yeah, because yeah, absolutely. Because we look at Dame and we go, you got the short end of a stick. You come off very independent, and it's great, but it's like you... And I don't know Dame. I'm just like you. I don't know Dame. But to me, when Jay-Z talks about things, it's like, I'm past it. It hurt. I still move on, and I'm past it. With Dame, it's like a sense of, I'm still bitter about that in my voice, and it just made me harder. And it's like that bitter old man vibe. Like,
yeah.
Like... Like, play with me if you want to now, I'm going to get at you. Like, you know, in which, you know, to a point I understand, but also to another point, I'm like, you can't do that all the time, because that could ruin some business relationship if you come at it like a pit bull on everything. You got to find a balance.
Right.
I think the reason why Jay is so successful is because he found a balance.
Right.
And I'm not saying Dame's not successful. He has his own streaming platform. He does his own content. He has his own studio space. And he's working it. But
right.
I think his approach needs to be last resort. The problem that I see with Dame is Dame uses the last resort approach as his first approach. I'm going to get at you right here, right now, if I hear something wrong.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So... It's one of those situations where, you know, you got to be careful about like which approach you take, and timing is everything.
Yeah, Dame Dash, and he does go from 0 to 100 really quick. But I mean, I don't know how old you are, but I remember growing up watching Dame Dash in the videos. He was the crystal pouring the crystal on the women, and that's kind of the Dame Dash I remember. And then, of course, his fallings out. Yes, he's become successful despite the things that have happened to him. But I will say that I believe he could have been more successful, because if he was so influential in hip hop, if it was not for him, there would be no Rockefeller. But we don't look at Dame Dash in that same light because of what Dame Dash did or the things that he continuously does. Because when that fallout happened, everybody was looking at him with the side eye. But he actually did have some valid points had he been able to articulate it right. So he has a good basis for this argument. I just think that the way that he's going about it, just not the right way. And then the part with his children, that's something that you need to talk about your children with, because you can only be exploited on, I guess, reality TV.
Right.
If you allow it.
Right.
So that's a conversation he needs to have with his kids.
Right. I think, yeah, and that's another thing. You gotta have a sit down discussion with your kids and understand that there's some things kids don't know, especially being that young. So if they got this fancy producer walking up to them, trying to make them, you know, trying to goat them up, trying to have them be a star and this and that, and giving them the shiny star talk, and then you being the elder is like, look, they're saying this, but at the end of the day, their job is, they got a show to do, they're trying to sensationalize, and we are all black family. You need to be on your P's and Q's.
But do you feel that he's kind of passing some of the blame of the issues with his children off on someone else? Because clearly they've had some issues in the past, him and his children.
I think there needs to be, here's the thing. I do agree with that for this reason. Any family, deep family beef does not need to be displayed on television. Like, that needs to be talked about in private. Not everything needs to be on, you know, some Ayanna Van Zant fix my life type stuff. It does not need to be that.
Okay.
I think that some things need, I think we need to get back to, I think for, especially in the African-American household, I think we need to get back to making sure that whatever private, whatever conversations are going on are in private, leave the social media out of it, leave the reality television out of it, and let's figure out a way to have a conversation. Regardless, now, they don't, keep in mind, when it has, when it comes to the private conversation, you don't have to necessarily make up with the person. However, it does help the family from further embarrassment if you have it in private, more so in public, and a bunch of people don't even know what's going on, don't even know the details, and now they're throwing in their opinion, and then it becomes a bigger deal than it needs to be.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with that. I agree that you shouldn't have everything on social media. And as being a millennial, that's what we do. Like, we grew up with this analog childhood. Now we have this digital adulthood. That's what we do. We put everything out there on social media. But I feel like with Dame Dash, to me, when I heard what he was saying, it was like the WeTV is causing this divide. No. WeTV may be exacerbating this divide, but the divide was already there. So that's between you to talk to your children about. Like, I get a lot of that from him, too. Like, it's a lot of, it's somebody else's fault.
Yeah, definitely. It's one of those things where it can be a heck of a battle. And speaking of heck of a battle, this past weekend we saw a heck of a battle between RZA and DJ Premier. Now, I'll give my opening thoughts on it. This was a heavyweight. If you are a thorough hip-hop head, you love 90s and you love 90s hip-hop, this battle is right up your alley because you're getting all that plus more. I think they were on. I got through all 20 tracks of the battle. If we went just by the 20 tracks separately, in mm-hmm. my personal opinion, I think Premier won.
I think so too.
But it was close. Like, it was very close. I think Premier got him by like an inch.
I think so too. I would say that DJ Premier won as well, but I feel like we need like a mediator to come in because I feel like RZA kind of wasn't. He played like the whole song, where yeah. DJ Premier was playing like snippets. And I'm like, wait, like are you cheating? Like, what's going on here? I don't know. I think we should have a mediator in these battles.
Yeah, I think and the beauty of this is right now we're looking at the verse. We're looking at the idea of verses as it's in its early stages and it hasn't been finessed or produced well done yet. It's something that it's like it's in its raw form as of right now. You know what yeah. I'm saying? I think coming up, because now, and I don't want to get ahead of the topics here, but I know we got Babyface and Teddy Riley coming up. Mm-hmm. I think that battle is going to have some more. Well, hey, you can only play your songs for this allotted, you know, for this allotted time, and then let the other person go. But I think with this one, I think it was just such a. This was like they were in the alley and they were just having fun, and it was like a heavy. It was like the '90s throwback party. Like in some borough in New York somewhere.
Yes.
Like that's what it felt like. And it felt like it had that big fight feel, but everybody got along at the same time. Like,
yeah, you wanted to put your Timbs on when you yeah. listen to this. Yeah.
Right. Right. Like this is like even the, like, and just the aroma, just the boom bap and just the different, even RZA using some of the, using some of the Wu-Tang Clan tracks that he produced and stuff of that nature, and because, you know, he has that anime old, you know, old school like martial art movie type of influence on his stuff. Mm-hmm. So seeing that and then seeing Premier doing what he does best and then having them go back and forth, it felt like we was under the Brooklyn Bridge and we were just watching these people just go at it. It had a big fight feel. It's like you felt like you could feel the bonfire, the dogs barking, you're around New York City, but it was like everybody was getting along.
Yeah.
It was like the weirdest thing.
You could see the levels of respect, though. You could yeah. see the true admiration for one another's music through this battle, which I appreciated, that you can see that they truly took time to think about the songs that they were going to play, especially DJ Premier. I feel like he took time, sometimes too long, to figure out what song he was going to play. But I think that they also need to, yeah, I think the Teddy Riley battle or verse one another will be a little bit more refined. And I think it should be, because one of the things that I noticed when you look at all the people that are in the group, of course, they're all hip hop heads, but they're listening to the lyrics. So I'm like, are you listening to the lyric?
Or is it the
beat?
Or
are you listening to the beat? Because they produce the music, not necessarily the bars. Because I feel like that's where people, a lot of people were giving it to RZA, but I feel like they were giving it to RZA because of the bars, not the beat.
Right.
So I don't know. I think we need a mediator in order to be able to do that. Because I would give it to DJ Premier. I think his, just the catalog of music he has, he just has more outside music. So it's going to have a different sound. Whereas, right. I mean, of course, it always has his signature sound, but it's going to have a little bit of a different sound. Where I feel like RZA kind of gave us a lot of that Wu-Tang. And they have a signature sound. So it's kind of like very, very similar.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I'm not going to say, because he's hella talented. RZA right. is hella talented. But when it comes to this particular battle, I think even if you don't even listen to the songs that they put up against one another, I'm going to have to say that even just listening to the music, just in general, Premier won already.
Oh, yeah. I think now, over time, I heard some of the stuff that RZA was playing. I'm like, why didn't you play that in the 20 Earth. Songs?
Right.
Like, you should, like, if he played what he played in overtime, like, just when he was just playing tracks, I'm like, yo, if you would have done this, you probably would have won.
I don't know. See, to me, I feel like DJ Premier's, just his catalog, just in general, is better.
Right.
Just to me. It just, mm-hmm. But I do feel like there was some miscalculations on both their parts, because there were times yeah. where it was like, why would you play this up against that? Like, I don't think he played Cream until they were in overtime. And I'm like, why was that not one of the songs?
I think that was the last track he played. I think the last track he played of the 20 was Cream, which is, it makes sense, because that's the knockout blow. That's what, right. That's like, everybody knows Cream. Your 5-year-old son knows Cream. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Like, why would you not play this, like, I mean, sooner, to me. Right. And then it was a lot of people like, well, why didn't Premier play Annie Up? And I was like, well, he didn't produce that, so he can't yeah. play it, because yeah. he didn't produce it. So right. I think DJ Premier won, just his catalog alone. I just think he won. That's just me.
I would give it to him too. The thing about that I like about this is that every one of these battles, it's like it just takes a step up and step up and step up, and it keeps getting more competitive.
This was a good match, though.
A very good match. A very good match. Like, this is probably the best match that I've seen. Like, skill wise, style wise, it just matches up really well. And I kind of wanted to shine light on some of the other IG battle of the past too. The first one that I wanted to kind of shine on that was interesting. It wasn't as close as RZA and DJ Premier, in my opinion, was Scott Storch versus Manny Fresh. Mm-hmm. From my personal opinion, looking back on that battle, I felt like Scott Storch is a musician that knows how to make hip hop beats.
Mm-hmm.
Manny Fresh knows how to make hip hop beats, but he's not skilled in the musician bag as much as Scott is.
Mm-hmm.
And Manny, to me, only has one sound. I may catch heat for saying it, but it's like that Southern hip hop where Scott Storch seems like to have, like, he can go pop, he can go R&B, he can go give you the hip hop thorough record, and then he can mix the two or mix the three. You know what I mean? It seems like there's more variety with his stuff than Manny did.
Agreed. I mean, but that's who Manny is. So that's why when a lot of people set these verses or battles up, I don't understand how they're actually making the comparison. Like, is it someone that's saying, well, hey, I think you guys should be coupled together? Because if you look at, like, the catalog, like, I would, if I put Manny Fresh up against somebody, you're right. It would have to be a Southern producer that kind of was in a camp. Maybe like somebody in the No Limit camp and Manny mm-hmm. Fresh would make more sense to me. Right. Just personally.
It's got to be somebody from that. It's got to be somebody similar to his bag to make it more of a competitive competition.
Right. Like you can't really like put him up against anybody else because it just doesn't work. And I think that's where you get a lot of these battles where you're like, huh, why would you even do that? Because I think there's a French Montana and there's a Tory Lanez battle coming, which I don't know if I would put those two together. I mean, they are the kings of remix.
So I'll have a hot take about this and I'll give it right back to you. I personally think outside of the hits, I feel like French Montana is one of the most underwhelming rappers I've ever heard in the last 10 years. Tory Lanez, I think from a song standpoint, from a production standpoint, would get him up out of here. And I'm not even going to talk about Tory Lanez hits. I'm just talking about his music in general. Anything from the Chick Tapes is getting anything that French Montana puts up out of here. Now, if he puts on Shot Caller, like Tory's got to sit down. If he puts on I Ain't Worried About Nothing, Tory's got to sit down. But once the hits are gone and you talking about 20 tracks back to back, Tory's getting them up out of here.
Yeah, but I think that's also the issue with this battle, because a lot of the songs that Tory, they're like remixes of remixes to me. Like, so I don't know, who do you give that weight to Tory for remixing a remix that somebody already produced? Or are you going to give it to French, who has more of that originality, I would say, than Tory? Like, I probably get a lot of shit for this. I'm sorry. Can you curse on
you? You can curse
okay.
on me.
Okay. just making sure, because I sometimes let a couple loose. Well, I curse in general. Let me stop. I think that in that way, you got to give it to French because of the originality. What is the battle about? Is it about the biggest hits? Is it about the most unique sound, or is it about the originality?
So it depends on the category. If we're talking about they're just having a battle of who music's better, like from a quality standpoint and something that can bump, mm-hmm. Tory's taking it. If it's lyricism, if it's hits, so that's one category. If it's hits, I think Tory might take it by a close margin.
Okay.
The only reason why I'm saying that is, well, hold on. I'm thinking about it. If it's about pop hits and sonic hits and commercial records, French might take that. Now that I'm thinking about it, French might take that because I forgot about Unforgettable. And if he plays Unforgettable, it's a wrap. I forgot about that. So if it's about that, French is getting that. But if it's about anything else, if it's lyricism, Tory's taking it. French Montana's lyrics are, there's nothing about, I've never heard somebody say, good grief, French bodied that verse.
Right.
I've never heard that. So if it's verses back to back, Tory's taking that. If it's about who had the best, like, club record, we ain't talking about commercial, we talking about club indie record, I think Tory's taking that too.
Okay.
Unless French puts out a track that features Chinks on it.
Okay. I mean I think that French Montana, from a popularity standpoint, I think that he has bigger bangers. I think Tory is getting there because he's like on fire right now. Mm-hmm. But to me, I'm just not a big fan of, even though I know they've been doing that for years in the 90s, but I'm just not a big fan of people that take whole songs
and sample everything.
Yes. And I'm like, this is the same, like, literally, this is Usher's song. Like, that's why I like it. It's not because you're on it. This is Usher's song. Mm-hmm. I've always liked this song. those are the types of things that I'm like, I don't know. Like, can you use those songs in a versus, in a battle? Do they count?
It depends on the rules. If it depends on the situation of, okay, do remixes count in here? If we're doing sample tracks, how far does that go? See, all these rules need to be discussed. If they're gonna battle, what are they battling for? Because I'm telling you, if it's about anything else, if it's about lyricism, French is not lasting long in this battle. Okay, if it's about other stuff, French definitely has a chance to win because he's been around longer on a commercial standpoint. He's been around longer commercially than Tory has.
Mm-hmm.
But especially, I think that what is going to make Tory win, possibly if he has something that isn't released yet.
Okay.
That could be the next great hot summer record. If he has a Drake record, which wouldn't surprise me. If he has a Rihanna record, which wouldn't surprise me. If he has something like that, if he has like a sneaky surprise attack, like a left hook that you don't see mm-hmm. in a battle, then now it's getting interesting. Because now we looking at friends like, okay, he just released something that's unreleased. What do you have?
Right.
You know what I mean? So I'm just kind of going back and forth and trying to figure out, in this scenario, what would happen here? And that's the beauty about this.
True. That's true. I mean, I guess it's a little bit of that with the Little John versus T-Pain.
Oh, yes, well. Absolutely.
Which, to me, I would give it to, I don't even, to me, T-Pain doesn't have enough music to me to go up against Lil Jon. I like T-Pain and I like T-Pain's music, but this is Lil Jon.
Right.
It's the same. Well, I mean, both of their sounds are repetitive. I mean, you're going to get the same sound no matter what, but I would have to give it to Lil Jon.
Yeah, so in my personal opinion, I gave it to, and I do respect where you're coming from with why you think Lil Jon won. I think T-Pain won for this reason. T-Pain vocally is out of this world. The melodies is crazy. You mix melodies with his production. Hold on. I know people are going to frown on the auto-tune, though. But when his songs were coming out, the only people that complained about them were the people that weren't doing it. Nobody complained in the club when Buy Me a Drink was on, when I'm Sprung was on, when Bartender was on. You know what I'm saying? Nobody complained about these things.
Right.
So the only time people complained about it is when Jay-Z came out with Death of Auto-Tune, and then because it was Jay-Z, then everybody wanted to be rebel against it.
Yeah.
On the bandwagon. So, because it was Jay speaking out. And when Jay speaks out, people listen. So when you think about how talented he is vocally and what he can do with his voice, we ain't even talking about the lyric. We just talking about the beat he can produce.
Mm-hmm.
Little John is not vocally gifted, but what he's good at is adding a sense of hype and catchphrases to make the song bump and go even further.
True. I mean, so, yeah.
So, I mean, and look, I could be ticking off a lot of people saying this. I'm just giving my honest opinion. In my brain, a good beat, if you're able to use your voice as not only a vocal, but also a beat, mm-hmm. I have to give you points for that. And also, what T-Pain did was, he turned around and gave, he was the only person that I know that turned around and did almost like the transition. He had some of the craziest transitions into the song he was about to play I've ever heard throughout these series of these battles. Mm-hmm. Like him taking stuff and remixing it. And I have to literally, I'll probably go back and just watch him just literally take something, remix it, like take a familiar beat, remix and have it transition into the song that he wants to play to go battle Lil Jon. It was crazy to me. He is a thorough surgeon when it comes to producing. He's a thorough surgeon. I'm not taking it anyway from Lil Jon. Lil Jon's the king of crunk, hands down. He created a whole genre. Let's not look over the legacy of Lil Jon at all. Mm-hmm. I'm just mainly talking about this battle, and I'm saying when you could turn around and play the keys, you can use your voice as a beat, but you can also deliver on vocals. Because I know there's some songs back in the day when I was growing up, heads would skip a whole song just to get to the T-Pain verse because it was the most hyped verse in the singing part to sing along. I did it. You know what I'm saying? I did it. So, you know, it's one of those situations that, don't get me wrong, it was close.
Okay.
It was mad close. He played Shorty in OT. I thought he was gonna play it in his 20 songs. So I was kind of shocked about that.
Duplicate one though.
I
thought he duplicated something, but maybe he didn't.
Yeah.
But I would say the reason why I give it to Lil Jon is because
One second though, can we have you like be more centered? No problem. All right, now you go ahead.
So with Lil Jon, I just feel like Lil Jon won this simply because of the catalog. And when you put Yeah in there, like the hits that, yes, like I'm in love with a stripper. I sing that song. I love this song. Right. I sing all of T-Pain songs. Just anybody who sings T-Pain song, you feel like you can sing because, you know, the auto-tune sound. But when you look at the things that Lil Jon has done, oh my gosh. I don't know, especially when you're looking at the bangers, the hits of it.
Did he even play Yeah in his 20? I don't think he played Yeah in his 20. That's the shocking part. Lil Jon did not play Yeah in his 20. I was shocked by that.
Did he?
I remember. No,
I think it was in the 20, if I'm not mistaken. I believe it was in the 20.
Okay. I may be wrong, but I don't, because that's the crazy part. I don't remember hearing it. I was like, yo, Lil Jon got hits, but he didn't even play Yeah. If he had played Yeah in the 20, I would have been like, all right, here come the knockout blow. I'm worried for T-Pain now.
Yeah, because that Yeah was the biggest song in 2004.
Yeah, easily.
It continued on in 2005. That song changed the game. So I would say just by looking at his repertoire, Lil Jon won hands down. Now, I will say that that's a good matchup, though.
Yeah, absolutely.
The rest of them kind of sucked, but that's besides DJ, of course, Premier and RZA. That was a great one. And if you like hip hop, that was hip hop. Like, right. That definitely was hip hop. That and the Lil Jon T-Pain was a really good matchup to me. The rest of them were kind of like a little, I don't know.
Yeah, the rest of them were kind of like, I don't really like it. This ain't must-see TV for me.
Yeah, but I'm excited about the Babyface Teddy Riley. I was just shocked that a lot of the younger people were saying that they kind of count Babyface out, which to me is hilarious.
When people see this battle, I think it's going to make people wake up and realize, like, dang, Babyface really put some hits together. Babyface really put some hits together, and I just forgot. Like, people really sleep on Babyface, and because he's so quiet and humble and doesn't come out and say much, and he's kind of from that old generation that is, like, older generation, more mature generation, that, you know, it's kind of this mystique to him. You know he was a pillar in R&B, but you don't know what he necessarily had his hands on.
Right.
To most generations now, to my mother's generation and you know, older, it's like, I could tell you every song he knows. Right. You know what I mean? So it's one of those situations where I think millennials are going to be reminded and also be shocked as to what he had his hands in.
Yeah, because honestly, I think it's a good matchup, but I think it's going to be a blowout. Because, like you said, I don't think people realize what Babyface had his hand on. It's more than whip appeal. Like, I love whip appeal, but he's more than just whip appeal. Like, he's written for so many people. He's produced so many songs that no one knows about. Didn't he do Waiting to Exhale soundtrack?
Mm-hmm. He had his hand in that.
Like, that was... Listen, if you grew up in the 90s and you had a black mother, you was listening to that.
That was in rotation. Waiting to Exhale played at my mother's house several times on repeat.
Yes.
Especially in the 90s. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
And if it came on, it's one of them things, if it's on, you don't turn it off till it's over.
Right. Yeah. Right. Amazing movie, but the songs in that... Fire.
The soundtrack, the whole sound, it's one of the hottest soundtracks I've heard. Easy.
Fire. Like,
top to bottom.
Undeniable. When are they supposed to do that? The 18th?
It is supposed to be April 19th, I'm thinking. Hold on. I'm going to click on the link and get the actual date as to when this will be happening. I think it's Saturday, April 18th.
So okay.
Saturday, April 18th, this will go down. And I'm looking up the time now for it. I'm trying to see what time. So it's April 18th, 6 p.m. No, 6 p.m. Pacific time, 9 p.m. Eastern. Yeah. So 9 p.m. Eastern time, April 18th, it will be Teddy Riley versus Babyface. And after this, I don't want to hear nobody say, oh, I'm too good to go on an IG live battle. After these two do it. That's all I got to say.
Are they doing IG Live? Because I know that there was some controversy that Teddy Riley wanted to use an outside, like...
No, they're going to do IG Live. Swiss Beats just confirmed it on his Instagram. So if Swiss Beats, who's kind of become kind of the Dana White and Timbaland's kind of become the Vince McMahon of this whole entire going back and forth. So... yeah, it's set in stone. This is what's going to be going on.
Okay. All right. So that's good to know. Teddy Riley in the back. Yep, yep. So we're going to get what we need, even though I don't know the 20 he would. I mean, Teddy Riley actually has had his hands in a lot, too. Teddy Riley has had his hands in a lot. I just feel like his songs just don't compare to the longevity of what Babyface was able to create.
Yeah, unless Teddy Riley puts on an MJ song, he'll get Babyface up out of here.
Yeah, but like, even
remember
still,
the time you got to be quiet.
Yeah, but that's only one.
I know.
You so you can't win the battle off of one. Like, I'm just thinking about the other songs that he could come up that could potentially make this a knockout, drag out blow.
I get that, but Teddy Riley is like the godfather of New Jack Swing, so he could turn around and put Guy on. He could turn around and put on a Bobby Brown song. Who knows? Who knows?
True. True. I mean, yeah, he could, but I still, like I said, I don't know. I just feel like Babyface just has so many.
Right.
He has classics.
Right.
I mean, so does Teddy Riley, but just when you think about the longevity of the changing of the game, of the R&B changing the game.
The line goes through these two.
Yeah, I don't know. It's going to be a great battle, though, but I'm still giving it to Babyface. I think Babyface is going to pull out some... He's going to dig in the crates.
Especially when you this quiet, like, is Teddy Riley doing more talking than Babyface right now? Nobody knows.
Sick. He had COVID-19, him and his family.
Yeah, and he just put out that he just tested negative for it, so that's a good sign.
Oh, he did. He did have it. Okay.
Yeah. He tested negative. He said they did get tested for it. He did say that it tested negative.
Okay.
So moving into speaking of COVID-19, Diddy hosted a viral town hall meeting with politicians and other personalities in hip hop about how coronavirus is affecting Black America. So I'm gonna ask you this question. I'm gonna let you have the floor with this. Did this help out at all? Why not?
No, I don't think so. I feel like Diddy comes from a really great place. Like, he tried to do this with the revolt summits that they had before on race. And he did one in California and then he did one in Atlanta. But The answer is no. And the reason why I feel like it didn't help is because he's not asking the people in the community. You're asking these people that have already been kind of put up on these pillars on the shelf and asking them their opinion. Although they're still within our culture, I feel like sometimes they get disconnected. Diddy has not been poor or has to worry about health insurance or money or any of this stuff for so long that sometimes I think they get disconnected from the culture of what people are going through. Having these types of conversations help, but it's better when you open up the platform to people like you and I. We can better explain what is going on these front lines. And when you ignore that just because somebody is a celebrity, what is Big Sean going to do for me? The only people that I think actually made some really, really great and valid points were Fat Joe and Ayanna Pressley. The rest of them, it was just noise. Like, we got it. Like,
it's stuff we've heard before.
Right. It was like, we got it. All right. But I feel like he tried to do something. Same thing he did with the Revolt Summit, which I feel like was a debacle, by the way, the first one. But it did not help. You cannot have a summit for the people without the people. You need the people. You could have at least asked somebody to come on this live conversation. And then outside of it, you need action items. I know he was asking for them, but what are those actionable items outside of this platform? We didn't get that. So I would say no.
Yeah, I do agree that there needs to be, if there's ever going to be a viral town hall meeting, if you're going to do something like that, you need to have people that are out there in the community on your platform talking about what's going on. What would have been more great is to have a first responder on the front line. What would have been great is to have a nurse. What would have been great is to have a doctor. What would have been great is to have somebody who is in the community giving food away, because they'll give you a firsthand account as to what's going on. I hate to say this. I don't need a Democratic personality telling me what black people are going through. I get that enough on CNN and NBC and whatever publication there is there. And I live it, so I know. What are the solutions now? This is here. We can't change it. We can't sit over there and we can't press rewind. We can't go back. We can't press forward either. This is going to be stuck here till we figure it out. There are no solutions, concrete solutions, that were given in this town hall meeting.
Yeah.
Nobody said, hey, let's come up with a plan to create businesses that are about natural home remedies.
Right.
To educate and put those into these inner city, lower income places, and let's re-educate those societies on how to eat better and also be aware as to what's going on. Let's do this now.
Right.
Now, I just came up with the solution off the top of my head, and I do not have the platform anywhere as big as Revolt TV or Diddy as of right now. So if I can think that into my head, you had literally a panel of 8 to 10 people, and none of these people sat over there and said anything like that?
Right.
So when I sit over here and I'm looking at that and I'm thinking to myself, I just came up with this on the fly. How come you got 2 hours of some of the most influential people currently? Right. Oh, I'll say influential with parentheses because it depends on who you ask.
That's right.
You know, some people rolled their eyes when they saw Al Sharpton up there. Some people still praise him. I'm not coming at Al Sharpton. I'm just being honest, and I'm saying some people either love Al Sharpton or hate him. When you see these people up there and they're talking, okay, Angela Rye's on there, great, and that's cool. Mm-hmm. But what solutions as a collective between the rappers, between the politicians, and between Diddy himself, are y'all going to take money out of your pocket and build a home remedy shop for cheap prices that you'll still get a profit off of in these inner city communities? So that way the community not only gets the education, but also gets proper food and nutrition. Is that going to be implemented? Are we going to have online classrooms that talk about how to build a business within your community and what permits and what stuff that you need to watch out for, so that way our community doesn't get gentrified again over and over and over again? Because if they're not doing that, this is nothing but white noise. And we're going to be having the same conversation 5 to 10 years from now.
I agree with that. And you may hear my dog in the background.
No problem. I agree.
I think that a lot of the times we don't move forward as a culture because we're waiting for somebody to do it. And I feel like Diddy, he wants to have this leadership role, but in a leadership role, you've got to have some type of plan in order to get stuff done. Just constantly having these meetings on top of meetings and summits on top of summits, they're not changing anything. It didn't change anything when he did the vote one. It didn't change anything when he did the race one. And I agree with you. Like, you have to have some conversations about, you know, what are we going to do? And then talking to people that are actually there. I feel like that's the biggest part that is missed. We never talk to the people that are actually in the community. It's only Sean King, Angela Rye. And there's nothing wrong necessarily. You know, I have my own opinions about some of these individuals, but you get what I'm saying.
Right.
Sean King, Angela Rye, Van Jones. I get it. They're all lovely people, I'm sure. But they're not necessarily in the same issues on the front lines. Like you said, why are we not talking to a nurse or a doctor that's in the epicenter, New York? Why are we not talking to them? These are the types of things, because if you know that African Americans are being hit harder than anyone else, you need to be talking to a doctor. We need a nutritionist up there. We need a therapist up there. These are the types of things that we needed in that platform, and we didn't get it. Not to mention that I think it was poorly put together. Like, it just was not put together. For Diddy to have as many resources as he has, I felt like it was not put together well. Like, you could have waited. Just me personally.
Yeah, I look at it like this, right? I think that he felt there need to be a sense of urgency. And while, yes, I do appreciate the sense of urgency, like, even, you know, even now he's putting together a dance-a-thon to have the profits go towards some of the first responders and stuff of that nature, which is cool. And you're trying to do something. But the thing about it is, his education on the philanthropy and the inner city issues are a little bit lapsed, because you've been so far. And I'm not saying he doesn't know what it's like to be poor. He grew up in a part that was poor, and he rose to that occasion. Not saying he don't know what it's like to be poor, but what it's like to be poor when he was growing up versus what it's like to be poor now, totally different. You know, back in the day, you get a condo for $50,000. Now condos are going for $300,000 to $400,000.
Right.
A little different now. So, you know, it's one of the situations where you have to really, you know, understand where you're at. Like, okay, I've been in this position as a, you know, a rich African-American male. Mm-hmm. What are these people thinking in 2020? What are these young kids out here thinking? Because it's different than when I was poor and living in the hood.
Right.
So, you know, it's one of those things, like, somebody's got to have their ear to the ground on a deeper level. Somebody has got to talk with the community leaders that are never seen in front of the camera, that have been on the front line for the past 20, 25 years, that never came up for an interview. We want, and it has to be genuine. That's another aspect. It has to be genuine. This is not for Showtime at the Apollo time right now.
Right.
It has to be genuine. So I think that's why we sometimes see some of these people, and as us as minorities, is like, which is valid when I say this. Okay, this talking head over here, okay, this person who we've never seen the past couple of years, the rise of AOC, Alexandria Cortez, who, I mean, these past couple of years, I saw her face here and there. It's good that we are having these faces speak out, but what are they doing themselves? What initiatives are they working with, to the point we can see something that's tangible, where we can look at a complex and be like, oh, they came down here and helped out with that.
Right.
Oh, they came down here and helped with this community down here, and now this community is now thriving even though they're poor.
Right. And she's in Congress, so I'm pretty sure she's doing something, especially for her in New York, because she's a congresswoman in New York.
Yeah.
But I will say that I agree with you that we need to talk to people that are the grassroots people, the people in the community that people actually know. They see them every day doing X, Y, Z. Like, just seeing somebody on television is not going to get it done. Just right. seeing somebody come out and talk about it every now and again, like, this is what you should do for Black people, but haven't done anything. I'm not saying if Diddy doesn't know what it's like to be poor. He did grow up poor, but because it's been so long, you get disconnected. Like, you do. When you start to become privileged, you forget how it is to not eat and that everybody is not going to be able to just make it. Because you get a lot of that bootstrappiness. But again, you sometimes have to give people some help in order to get them to the boots so that they can put them on. I think that's the part that we're missing. The disconnect is, all right, we need to get some actionable items, but I think it's also, we need to take some accountability as well, which I think that's something that is also missed, because we are getting sick at a much higher rate, African-Americans, because we have all these things stacked against us in America.
Right.
The, you know, unfair housing, unfair access to income, the wealth gap that will never close, no matter what anybody says. Like, these are things that are there and they're already stacked against us. But we also make some choices that are not good for our community. And if we don't accept that, I'm in Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
So Baltimore, if you know anything about Baltimore, and I love
Trust me, I'm from Maryland too. So we understand.
Okay. If you know anything about Baltimore, we have a lot of issues in Baltimore City. But a lot of it has to start within. Like, we're still waiting for somebody to come in and fix it. But if you don't hold the people accountable that are already there, nothing's ever going to change. Like, you need to start doing the little things first in order to get the ball rolling. Because even though COVID or Rona, whatever you want to call it, coronavirus is out there. But no one cares. Because it's like, I got all this other stuff going on. Like, I'm not worried about that. So we need to still take some accountability for the things that are going on in our communities so that we can make sure that the people that are saying, well, I'm not going to worry about that, know that you need to worry about this because you can get sick and other people can get sick. So we need to be able to have some of those levels of accountability in order to start making sure that things start to change. Like, you can make sure that you stay home or making better food choices, because a lot of times we're getting sick. Not only are we in service jobs, but also because we make poor food choices. Even when we have access, like, there's some desert food deserts out there. But when we have the choices to make, we don't always make the best choices health-wise, food-wise. And so we have to be able to know that that's where it starts. Like, we need to be healthier as a culture, a society, as opposed to just, you know, I need my seasonings.
Right.
Like, you know, I get it. I like seasonings too, but them seasonings are causing you to have high blood pressure. We might want to reconsider.
Then you caking all that seasoning on, and then you caking it onto the food.
I get you. I like seasonings too.
Yeah, absolutely. It's one of those situations where, and also when it comes to nutrition, we have to start shopping to live instead of shopping to save pennies. Because sometimes, you know, going to the grocery store and getting that drink that is $1, but it's got 60% corn syrup in it and 10% juice, and the rest of it is stuff you can't even name. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, what's the point of paying for the dollar? There's a reason why you go to the store and you see the Naked juice is like $4, because that's pure fruit.
Right.
That's mostly pure fruit. You're going to feel better if you drink that over the lemonade or the Arnold Palmer sweet tea that's got corn syrup in it. They don't want to tell you that, but it's got corn syrup in it.
Yeah. I mean, but the sad part is the joke is on us, because we always tease white people for not having seasoned food. Oh, look at the way they eat, you know, look at Karen with the Ravens, but isn't the joke on us? Because they're a lot healthier than we are. So the joke is on us. We need to consider that as well.
Right. The food may be a little bit more not as seasoned, but they just saved a high percentage of sodium intake.
Yes. And it's more than just fat. We got to worry about the sodium, and we got to worry about the sugar, because we got diabetes, we got high blood pressure, and all of that stuff that's potentially, we are at higher risk of it, genetically speaking. It doesn't mean we have to have it, but genetically we're at higher risk, so we have to watch it more so. And of course, I've been hearing people talking about, like, especially with us, I will say this, because a lot of African Americans don't believe that, some people don't believe that Black people can get it, coronavirus, which I think is also part of the issue of why we're getting it. And then, of course, the disparities of us working in service fields and not having access to masks and stuff like that. But the conspiracy theories are not helping. And I feel like a lot of them, they don't necessarily start in our community, but I feel like as Black people, we distrust the government so much because of all the things the government has done. Now, we, if anybody deserves to have a conspiracy theory, it's Black people. Like, we deserve to not trust the government because of all the things that happen. But I will say that if you have a conspiracy theory, at least make it make sense. Like, this 5G's, like, I get you.
Yeah, from a scientific standpoint, it's not even enough 5G towers to even equate to this even being a legit theory. And that's why I look at people so strangely, because it's like, are you serious? Like, you think it's about, you think we're stuck in a house over 5G stuff?
Yeah, we pretty much tanked our economy because we want Verizon to have 5G towers. Like, those are the types of things that don't make sense. But I think that also contributes to why it's impacting us. And I think Diddy did talk in this particular special. I think he talked about it briefly with what is going on as far as the, some of the conspiracy theories, but he didn't really touch on that either. But I think it was because he just called his friends as opposed to people that could actually make a difference. And then I was kind of also wondering in this special is, how did he make the determination of who to call?
That's what I was wondering. When I saw the lineup, and I saw, no offense to him, I like him as an artist. I have no problems with him at all. I don't know him. He used to go to Towson University, my school.
I graduated from Towson. Go Tigers.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. It's weird. It's funny how people are similar. So I'm sitting over here and I'm looking at the situation. I said, and the first thing I thought on the panel was, I was like, why is YBN Cordae of all people in this discussion? No offense to him, but I'm like, he's only so young and he doesn't have he's just like me. He doesn't know the details about, from a scientific perspective or from a medical perspective, about this doggone virus. Like, well, why is he on the panel?
Right. It's like Trump giving us medical advice. Like, it makes literally no sense at all. Like, why are you here, sir, at these health meetings? It just makes no sense. And I think that's another reason why I think it was it wasn't effective, because of the people he chose. Like, if you're going to say, well, I need different leaders because I can't talk to everybody in America, at least ask the people, who should I talk to? Like, who do you want to hear from? Who are your leaders in the community? Because I can guarantee the people that he picked are not necessarily it. And it's nothing wrong with the people that were there, but I think that he could have incorporated some other individuals. But I'm glad that some of the people he chose, he did, because Fat Joe, like I said, I didn't expect him to probably give some of the best commentary that there was, and he did. He was able to really relay the fact that the kids are not listening to us. They don't see the impact. You need to be able to get to them, because they're the ones that are going to be the most impactful on this virus, because they can be asymptomatic. They're less likely to get sick, so they're more likely to travel around and pass it back and forth. The fact that he was one of the only people to kind of like address that specifically was problematic to me.
Right. Absolutely. So, moral of the story is, get the people on the front line to be a part of these panels. Get people that are from the grassroots to be a part of these panels. Lise, I want to thank you for coming on. We have to wrap up here, but I didn't want to wrap up without you being able to share a little bit of info about your platform before we close. So go ahead. The floor is yours.
Okay. So I have two podcasts. They're both under the same umbrella. So you can find us at the same place, which is just millennials.us, and that's millennials with a Z. So basically, Millennials Anonymous, or MAPS, Millennials Anonymous Podcast, is a platform for millennials. We talk about everything that impacts millennials, from relationships to politics to student loans. And it's an open platform to pretty much say whatever you want. We have guests from all walks of life that come on, and we've talked to every person from a Black Trump supporter all the way to a male exotic dancer. Like, we talk to everybody. If you want to hear about it, we're going to tell you about it. And then, of course, Brunching is the group podcast that I'm on that we air live. So if you want to watch a video of us just acting an absolute fool, you are welcome to do so on YouTube under Brunching Podcast, or on Facebook under Millennials Anonymous Podcast, where we talk about everything that's happening now. So it's a popular culture podcast. We just were on today, actually, talking about all the things that have passed over the last week. So check us out, and you just www.millennialswithaz.us.
Well, at least we want to thank you for coming on. Definitely check out her platform. Any way that I can support the platform, I'm happy to do so. And I want to thank you for coming on Audio Airstrike and being a blessing and kind of giving gems with me and kind of sharing our honest opinion, because at the end of the day, this is a platform where, similar to yours, we kind of just share our platform. We're very unapologetic about it, but we're also respectful. And so I definitely appreciate you coming on, and thank you for taking the time out to do so.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yep, absolutely. Well, this has been another edition of Audio Airstrike. Until next time, everybody, see ya.